Oh, what a day! What a lovely day!
Welcome to Flat Earth Debate Live. I'm your host, Nathan Oakley, and if you are new to this channel, or you've not done so already, then be sure to subscribe, hit the bell notification icon and join button if you'd like to become a Nathan Oakley 1980 channel member and keep up to date with the Flat Earth Debate. If you'd like to support the channel, there is a Super Chat that runs alongside each of these shows while they are live. There's also a PayPal, Patreon, and crypto link in the info box below the video. Most importantly, if you'd like to join the discussion, simply mute the page you are currently watching, then click the link in the info box below this video to join the panel and express your views on the nature of Earth. If you do join, please don't swear. If you do, you'll be ejected, and if you are, please don't try to rejoin the stream using sock accounts. You'll be warmly welcome back on the next stream. Please also share the show on social media. Sharing the show obviously increases the live audience, but this in turn increases the chances of a more diverse panel. So please share the show on Facebook and Twitter. And one last time, if you're new to the channel or you've not done so already, then be sure to subscribe, hit the bell notification icon and join button to keep up to date with the Flat Earth Debate. Now we are joined by Paul Hall, Flatsoid and Tenth Man in G+, together with a whole bunch of people in Discord. So welcome one and all.
Good morning.
Dumelang.
Good morning.
Wow, enthusiastic crowd we are.
I was going to say, anybody in Discord going to say hello?
Hello, hello.
Excellent. We do have a Discord server to speak to. Any signs of a physical geometric sphere edge? Formerly known as Earth Curve?
No. No.
My rocking chair.
That's a fair point to say no at. Physical geometric sphere edge. No!
My sprayboard looks very flat and level.
Sorry, level. I cut you off.
It's a good point too. Geometric sphere edge? No. But axial rotation of the Earth base variety. Any evidence of that?
We have evidence of star rotation. Man.
That's nice.
How does that prove axial rotation?
Yeah, Paul, how would that prove axial rotation? Let's see your claim laid out, Fundy Globehead.
I didn't make that claim. I said that's proof of that. You just said evidence of star rotation. I didn't say anything what that implies. I just said the stars are rotating. That's all I said.
That's nice. Grass is green.
How about Commander Willy?
What about him?
With the stars and the rotating and the millions of stars. He just asserted that we're moving.
Well, yeah. That's the claim, isn't it?
Yeah, I was going to say that's their claim. What you mean is he tried to prove the claim by just asserting it. Is that what you mean? He just begged the question, Neil. Is that what you're trying to point out?
Yeah, I mean, can we get some proof that we're moving? I would like proof.
We can disprove it. If we were moving, there'd be a 15 degrees an hour deviation as Earth rotates underneath anything not attached to it. I mean, that's what they claim, right? Football makes the goal, because it's seeming to drift through the goalposts. Well, only seeming to drift, because you're turning underneath according to the claim that proves Earth spinning in their vernacular and rhetoric. Well, that's Coriolis effect. But we don't observe that. Nothing's rotating underneath an aeroplane at 15 degrees an hour because it's short in flight times. You don't see your drone drift away at 15 degrees an hour while it hovers because you're rotating underneath it. That doesn't happen. So no.
Isn't it safe to say that they don't know what Coriolis is?
Most of them don't. They try and tell us about how things are occurring in an inertial reference frame that you're supposed to be describing an observation from a non-inertial reference frame, so most of them just start describing the wrong thing for Coriolis so they don't understand it. Yeah, you're right.
But Nathan, hurricanes.
Yeah, hurricanes have an actual spin direction, and Coriolis effect is not actual deflection. Something seeming to drift at 15 degrees an hour. So when I say a drone would drift away from you, the drone goes up and hovers. It just hovers. It doesn't move in actuality. It's just hovering. But if we had Coriolis effect, it would seem to drift away from you if you're in California at like 800 miles an hour. Now, it's just hovering, but Earth's rotating underneath it. It's not actually drifting away from it. You're spinning away from it. That's Coriolis effect. Now, a hurricane's got an actual spin direction. You're not looking up at it, seeming to drift, because you're spinning underneath it. It is actually spinning. So that's not Coriolis effect. That's observing something with an actual spin direction, as opposed to not actual drift at 15 degrees an hour, because you're turning underneath something not attached to a spinning reference frame. Well, that hurricane is actually spinning. Unless you want to assert that you're in the hurricane, spinning with it, observing things seem to drift, because you're in a hurricane spinning around. That would be the only example with a hurricane in it that would include Coriolis. You spinning in a hurricane, observing things seem to drift. Whoa, I'm in a hurricane, but look at that house. It seems to be coming towards me. It's actually me spinning in a hurricane. That'll be Coriolis, but no one's ever going to detail that, are they?
Well, you got morons like Cole Shore that tell you move straight.
Yeah, the cow. Right, in Twister. The cow that whips past their windscreen, it's whirling around in the Twister. Well, that could be a cow that could describe Coriolis deviation. The cow goes, moo, 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 moo. That's translated into English as, look at that house, it seems to be coming towards me. It isn't, it's the cow spinning around. No, the house isn't moving, right? Well, that's Coriolis deflection that the cow's mooing about.
They got a moose problem.
Right on.
Or you got Kosho that says hurricanes move in a straight line.
Yeah, Kosho thinks they move in a straight line and we just see them appear to drift because we're turning underneath on a non-inertial spinning Earth. Well, that would, of course, shorten flight times if we were turning underneath planes and wind and everything else that's not attached to Earth. You know, you'd have a flight from Charlotte to LA taking an hour and a half instead of 4.5 hours because Earth would be rotating underneath. Shout out to Truth in Your Face. Hey, Roscoe. When I stand on a travelator, I can feel that I'm moving. And that's only like 0.5 kilometers per hour. Right on. You'd feel it if you're moving. We're not feeling anything because we're not moving. We're not observing deviation because nothing's in an inertial reference frame with us turning underneath. You know, we're just not spinning. It's just that simple. Coriolis actually debunks their claim that we spin.
No, I know. Conservation of momentum.
That's not Coriolis effect, though, is it?
I don't know, though. I don't think you can really feel if you're moving, except if there's wind around, but your senses will definitely tell you if you're moving by observations and all these things. And it will tell you that if you change from standstill to moving, you know, the acceleration is definitely measured. But I think people could be fooled if they're like in the back of a moving truck and it's not shaking. Well, yeah, that's a bit difficult. That, yeah, they, if it would go constant enough for a long period, that they wouldn't be sure at some point if it actually was moving or not.
Hey, Arwen.
Well, I'd have to disagree with that.
I'd disagree with that too.
You know how you put small children to sleep when they can't fall asleep, Arwen?
You rock them.
Yeah, but again, that's the motion. That's the shaking. That was very specific.
Hang on, let me finish.
Not shaking, rocking. There's a distinct difference. Right. Shaking will get you arrested. Rocking will send them to sleep.
Let me finish.
No.
So we put them in our car and we drive around and they fall asleep to the movement of the car and then we put them to bed. Did that many times.
Yeah, so what's moving it? The engine? The engine shaking?
No,
the
they feel
roaring,
movement.
The vibration?
You're missing the point. They feel movement.
No, they don't.
How come they fell asleep?
Because of the engine.
Because they were tired.
No,
okay.
Funny, man.
What's this proving or disproving? Kids. Just out of interest, Arwen, because you're making the claim that you wouldn't detect it. What's this proving, Arwen?
Well, that you notice the motion by other senses, vibration that typically come with it. No, even air friction, all that. That all adds to letting you know you are moving. But if there is none of that and there's no acceleration and no visual senses, no windows to the outside, it's just moving for a very long constant time. Let's say you fall asleep, wake up again, you wouldn't necessarily be sure if you were moving or not unless there was vibrational signs of this or visual.
I disagree with that.
Hold on, Brian. Go ahead, Brian.
Yeah, thanks, Nathan. Yeah, my father, before he passed away, he was seen as blind by the Council of the Blind in our country. So he knew when he was in a car moving at a constant rate on a new highway, a new motorway, with no other traffic, just moving at a constant rate, the cruise control on, he knew he was moving.
Yeah.
He knew he could feel it.
Yeah, Owen's agreeing with you on that score. He's saying under ideal, perfect circumstances that probably couldn't be achieved, and there was no vibration, and there was no acceleration, and there was no indication from any other means that you were actually travelling, even though you were, then you may not detect it. That's Arwen's point. Now, it coincidentally right. is their assertion about a sphere Earth, but that's all shot to hell when you use Ute Hube's point that he used to labour that we were shills because we weren't talking about the speed changes, right? It's moving in different axes. It's not just travelling in a rotational motion. It's got lots of different motions that it's going through, and those would exhibit speed changes as you change the direction, like a waltzer. Well, you'd feel that. We don't. There isn't anything to feel. We're not moving. We're completely smegging stationary.
Yep. Yeah, there would, look, on a spinning ball Earth, there would be all kinds of centrifugal elements that would add on to the natural state of things. And even if just subtle, it would be noticeable in some way. And it's not. So therefore, by moving over the Earth in a steady speed, there is no way to for you to tell unless there is vibration, because the Earth is stationary. If it wasn't, there would be other effects on top of that.
Go on,
you would have reference frame issues.
Go ahead, Flatsoid.
Believe me, you'd realize if you're moving 460 meters a second.
Well, maybe not if you're on a maglev rail that just goes in a perfect straight line for 100 miles.
Are we living in your imagination?
No, we're drawing out concepts and being absolutely exact and not just settling with, but I experienced this in my car.
Well, make a right turn at that speed.
I would bring us back to the moving sidewalk in the airports. They are very, very smooth, and yet you know you're moving.
Yeah,
you're not
Roscoe's
feeling vibrations
point.
If you close your eyes.
Yeah, that was Roscoe's point, the guy who made the super chat. Thanks again, Roscoe.
Yeah, that's what. Yeah, I'm referring back to him.
Move on. Any more on axial rotation of the Earth-based variety? I've got your stars playing, by the way, 10th man.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, well, 15 degree is what they say, right? And they're not saying that the sun and the stars above us are moving 15 degrees. They're saying the Earth is moving at 15 degrees per hour, which tells us that that's why it appears that the sun and the stars are moving. So as Chocolate pointed out from, I think it was Ben's video or somebody's video, where you go above the Earth and they keep moving still. So try to get out of that one.
But they say the moon is moving around us. They do say that. That is part of the rhetoric, yeah. The moon moves around us.
Right, but their argument is Earth rotation. Okay, well, how can we prove Earth is rotating? I'm looking out my window. Oh. I see the moon setting,
yeah.
And I don't see...
I wasn't finished.
Go ahead, then.
Right, the point I was making is, does the moon move at 15 degrees an hour?
Good question.
I don't know that.
But with their claim is Earth is moving, right?
Yeah, that's their claim.
Okay, so if you move Earth at 15 degrees an hour, what's it supposed to tell you? You're looking at star trails. They're saying those star trails is because the Earth is moving. Except you can get up on the drone and remain stationary, and the stars still move. So now you're no longer on the Earth that's turning. Why are the stars keep turning? See, it's pretty obvious.
They go back to the Earth. Yeah. Oh, yeah, it is. It's like, I mean, that's why they had to come up with the whole atmosphere lockstep with the Earth nonsense.
Well, we got a problem with that, don't we? We got a problem with lockstep atmosphere. Because number one, you got north, east, and south winds, not just westerly winds, which is the direction of the Earth rotation in their model. And then you've got the nature of gas and the behavior of gas.
Well, even more than that, sorry, even more than that, the problem is that that means there will not be any observable Coriolis effect.
That's from, the last point. So they're arguing against their very claim, right?
Yeah.
So they argue for deviation, and then when you break it down, they argue against deviation. It seems eerily resembling the black swan. You can't see the geometric horizon. But it blocks the bottoms of but it blocks the bottoms of the boats and buildings.
Indeed.
The geometric horizon's a ghost. Can't see it.
Unless it's blocking boats and buildings, then they can measure it in feet and inches, right, Chocolate?
Yeah, of course. Because that makes sense.
My bad. Of course. Silly me.
Good morning, guys.
Good morning, Chocolate. Good to have you.
Hello, everyone, as well. Sorry, I didn't come in there.
Oh, it's all good. Hey, Brian. Hey, Chocolate.
Yo, yo.
Did everybody get the memo?
Which memo?
That QE put out about Newtonian gravity. No longer do we speak about it.
Yeah, I mentioned that. I don't know if it was in the live show that we're having now or in the pre-show. But yeah, absolutely. A line has been drawn in the sand. It's 105 years, nearly 106 years out of date. No one's going to tolerate it anymore. No more Newtonian mass attracting mass force of gravity. It's been superseded. It's been replaced.
But is that even Newtonian gravity, though? I thought Newton didn't claim the hypothesis.
Newtonian. Newtonian, not Newton's gravity. Absolutely. He feigned no hypothesis. He didn't want it attributed to him. So what do they do, those funny buggers? The bloody psychos? Well, they attributed it to him, didn't they? I don't want any part of this. You know what? We're going to give it your name.
Thanks.
You know, it would be one thing if, like, he didn't expressly say, I don't want this attributed to me, right? It would have been one thing if... He didn't do that, but he actually said, please don't put this on me. I want nothing to do with it. And that's exactly what they did. It's great.
Yeah, so he did kind of say it. He just didn't say it verbatim, like in a lawyer, like addressing.
No,
letter.
But I'm saying, like, had he not said anything, you know, it would have been, all right, you know, they put it on him. But he expressly said, do not put this to me. Do not put this my name on it. I want nothing to do with it. And that's exactly what they do.
It's like, even detailed
the irony is lovely.
Even detailed what he was saying was nonsense. He asked this idea of a magical force of attraction. That's he specifically said he didn't want that attributed to him. So what's it called? Well, it's called Newtonian gravity, right? Of course. How dare he? that's how they behave. I'd really hate to have this attributed to me. Yeah, we're going to give it your name then. Bastard.
They gave it to him because he said it's absurd.
Who was the other guy with the stars that was like, they can't be at those distances, they'd be enormous. Who is that guy? Similar principle. They attributed it to him. I can't remember his name. I can never remember his damn name. The guy who put up an objection.
Michael Brahe.
Brahe, that's right. Right now that's told with the story of Brahe. In terms of these absolutely ginormous bodies, when you see all the CGI renderings of the CERN versus Betelgeuse and so on and so forth, well, that was originally an objection by Brahe. Oh, they can't possibly be at those. They'd be enormous, right? Now you have kids taught about how big Betelgeuse is. It's enormous, right? That's how they roll. That's just what they do.
Yeah, that's the absurdity of it, isn't it? It was sarcasm from Brahe. They just took his sarcasm and said it was real.
Yeah, they reverse engineered his objection and made it so. But in the case of gravity, it's Reverend John Michel, CB Boys, and who's the other guy? Get the other one. There's a third guy. Reverend John Michel.
You could do that in an ever-expanding universe. You could do that.
So didn't Newton have all this stuff in his Principia?
Principia.
So by these historical standards, I'm wondering now that if in 50 years if the world hasn't completely changed around, if they're actually going to attribute the final proof for the globe to us, to Bob and...
Well, yeah, hold on. Hold on. Excellent point, Arby. Can you just repeat that?
Yeah, well, if they're guns, historically, they've shoved all kinds of things into people's shoes that they officially and on record didn't even want to for themselves. They didn't want that attached to their name, even though they might have came up with it originally. So are they going to attribute the final proof for the globe in 50 years on all of us? That we literally, there was some doubt left about whether the Earth was a ball or not, because it's so complicated. And the flat earthers finally worked out with absolute definitive certainty that the Earth was a globe through all their experimentation. Would they go
there?
That's
exactly what you mean. Just like they said. Nathan Oakley. Newton said, don't put this on me, and they put it on him. We're out here saying Earth is flat, and sooner or later they'll be like, hey, look at these guys that said the Earth is flat. They actually proved it was a globe.
I've just remembered who the third person was, and it seems so glaringly obvious now. It's Cavendish, CV Boys, Reverend John Michel, and Cavendish. That's who the gravities actually should be, in actuality, is ascribed to. Not Newton. It's just called that, Newtonian gravity. But it's 105 years out of date. The whole point of detailing this is that we've drawn a line in the sand and said, no, it's been replaced. Your current hotness is Einsteinian, pseudo-Riemannian force space. That's bending space-time. Not mass attracting mass. It's not a force. Made explicitly clear, even when you interview your own priests, it is not a force. Now, you can think of it as a force, but it's not a force.
No more. Shout out to Charles.
I got a small question. Sorry, Brian.
I said Cavendish, but I thought you had heard me. Sorry, I should have said that louder.
No, it's okay. I just forgot. Yeah, absolutely. You think it's... You go, who else has got these mass-attracting mass... Who is the other guy? Oh, yeah, Cavendish. Of course.
But isn't it extra ironic? Because I don't hear any objections from Cavendish about gravity. He's very readily assuming it. So might it be that they didn't call it Cavendish gravity because he was actually too eager for it to be attributed to his name. So they didn't pick him, but no Newton instead, because he didn't want it.
Well, that's not what he was doing. You know, the derivative G was from CV Boys. So he's trying to weigh Earth, right? That's what the Cavendish experiment, which it isn't, is supposed to be doing.
Yeah, it was the density of Earth.
Right.
Yeah, you're right. I forgot Cavendish doesn't actually prove gravity. It just assumes it, and ballers mistakenly call his experiment the proof for gravity, even though it just assumed it. I forget about that.
Seems so like probably. They're very good at misappropriating titles to events.
As we're on the subject, any scientific evidence of gravity?
Cavendish experiment.
No. Have you read the paper? If you did not read the paper, please do not speak about Reverend Michel Cavendish.
Reverend?
I've read the paper many times. What do you mean?
That's what the ballers say now. If you did not read the paper, how are you talking about it?
The data only shows torsion twist.
Man, what reading mean, the paper. Just...
In the second page of that paper, he's got a measurement of this gravity. 150 millionth of the weight of the ball.
I was going to preempt this, and you've done it for me. This ended in row. So looking at the paper, ends in a row with me back in the day with Sleeping Warrior, while me and QE are going, yeah, give it them. Who cares? It's not overcoming entropy, gases fill space. Anthony's digging way into the depths of Cavendish and showing us this 50 millionth to one. And I'm like, why do you want to beg this question? Yeah, give them it is our answer, because who cares? It's not overcoming entropy. His answer is, well, no, they're claiming it's a minuscule force. So I'm like, well, what are you going to do? Let them have it in an argument about gravity, but just say it's really small. So they've won. You've begged the question for them. But that was way back when. These days, Anthony's just like, yeah, draw a line in the sand. Cavendish gravity, my ass. It superseded 105 years ago by Einstein. Get with the program, fundies. Any more on gravity?
No, it's a reification fallacy.
Yeah, I have.
Go ahead, Brian.
What is the cause of weight?
What's that got to do with gravity? Unless you're imposing it onto mass attracting mass Newtonian gravity in an argument, what's your point?
Well, gravity all comes from weight. The whole concept of gravity, whether it be from Newtonian, Cavendish era, or Einsteinian, the whole concept comes from weight. Comes from the, that's why they use the word gravity as a bastardization of the Latin word gravitas, meaning weight.
Yeah, so that's what I just said. As soon as a fundy, I'm not saying you're that fundy, Brian, but absolutely, yeah, that's what I just said. They're imposing gravity on this word when they use it.
Yeah,
aren't scientists starting to move away from space-time?
Moving away from space-time? How long is that going to take?
The cause of weight is the bending of space-time, Brian. Come on.
No, when I say moving away, as in the... I had a quick glance, something about that... it's not fundamental. They're starting to realize it's not fundamental.
Yeah, it's just maths. It's not working on the really is level at all.
A lot of, astrophysicists and theorists, what are they called, are starting to sort of say that in their own words.
Absolutely correct. If you were to actually investigate any of these subjects we cover here, you'll find that the priesthood on their side, the globe side, lays it out like it actually is. It's mathematical reification. And they'll often say it, yeah, with a few weasel words peppered in between, but ultimately they're telling you. That's why I say this is only our own... It's our own fault. We didn't look into it. If we had, we'd see it laid out by their priests. That's all we cover here. That's why I'm in no danger of getting shut down by YouTube or anything of that nature. What, for discussing Musa saying, quote, gravity's not a force, but you can think of it as a force? This is your own priests telling you with doublespeak... It is not a force. But you can think of it as one.
Good point.
I was probably listening to
Planet Walk
too long yesterday.
It's an emergency force.
It's a what, skeptical?
Gravity is an emergency force. Token.
Chocolate got a good mention for this earlier, for having Craig over a barrel on this.
Yeah. The bending of space-time causes a force, which is the gravity force. And yeah, so gravity causes gravity. A non-force of gravity causes the force of gravity. Yes, it just happens. It's just a force out of nowhere. It just happens.
If you take a piece of steel and a piece of wood of equal volume, the steel will always be heavier than the wood. And the only answer, physics answer for that, is there is a greater density of matter. So steel is heavier than wood due to a greater density of matter. So density of matter is what gives things weight. Mass, the word mass, is attributed to the word matter by definition. And it's also attributed to the word density by definition and the word volume by definition. But the only time the word mass, is ever attributed to the word weight by definition, according to fundy mainstream pseudoscience, is when it's mass times acceleration of what they say is gravity, right? Which is mass attracting mass anyway, little g. But all the word mass does is it takes all the things that actually cause weight and separates them from their fundy belief of a fundy 105-year-out-of-date belief of mass attracting mass. So they can't even show how Einstein's theory of general relativity, through that, how the supposed effect of gravity causes weight. They can't even show that. So they have to keep on going back to this this separation with the word mass from all the things that do cause weight from this supposed acceleration of gravity, which is supposed to be causing weight. So it's always using the word mass to infer little g. Take the word mass away, and little g can do nothing. It's helpless. Because it's blatantly obvious that it's an accumulation of matter.
Very succinctly put. Very well put, Brian. And the reason they can't... The reason they can't just show one in the other is because they're completely different geometries. They've got length, breadth, and depth versus length, breadth, depth, and time. So you can't translate one into the other. You can't superimpose a fourth dimension onto the Newtonian mathematics. It does not work. You can't translate one into the other. I know they assert it here. Rumpus especially will say, well, yeah, of course it is. Of course you can. One translates into the other. Show us. He's never going to show us. It can't be done. Where are you going to get fourth dimensional space-time in Newtonian mechanics? You can't. So you can't do that. That's why they won't do it. But they have to, as Craig did, and it was interesting to hear him verbalise his cognition with chocolate holding him to account on it, how you can get an emergent force from the uneven distribution of mass causing the bending of space-time, which is attributed to gravity in the current rhetoric of Einsteinian mechanics, and that effect giving rise to a force called gravity. So you've got the emergent force of gravity causes the force of gravity, according to these morons. You know, it's total doublespeak nonsense cluster screw.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, when any of them say that Einstein's field equations can be reduced to what they call Newtonian, which is actually Cavendish era gravity, what they're talking about is little g, which is not Newton. When they say that that his field equations can be reduced, what they're actually saying is they can be changed. So once they're changed, how are they Einsteins anymore? They're not.
Or
so
how
what
they,
they've got to do...
Or how are they Newtons? How are they Newtons? So they're not Newtons anymore. It has Newtonian has been superseded, replaced by Einsteinian. Now, the one doesn't back engineer into the other. One isn't based on the other.
No, exactly. But they think that it's okay to mathematically convert one to the other.
But they can't.
The same.
Stop. They can't. They say it's acceptable to do so, but they're never going to do it. They're never going to show. Ask next time that gets asserted to you, Brian. Ask them to show it you.
Oh, I know they can't do it. I'm always talking about their claim. I know they can't do it, but they're claiming they can do this. You know, I know they can't. I mean, how do they show, as I asked a while ago, how do they show weight being caused by the bending of space time?
Well, weight in their argument in this instance would be where they're performing the bait and switch. They're inferring Newtonian gravity when they say weight. So how do they go from inferences of Newtonian gravity to pseudo-Riemannian bending space-time? They don't. They end up making an embarrassment of themselves, like Craig did.
Yes, because weight then, going by what they try to say, weight is not a force anymore. It then becomes an effect.
Yeah.
If you understand what I mean.
Yeah, no, exactly.
I'm not saying
what
it really does.
Yeah, precisely.
But
can I just get a sound check from Chocolate?
Yeah, I'm here. What's up?
Does helium rise faster when it's not in a balloon?
Can you hear me?
Called the magic trick.
We do hear you, Chocolate. Thank you for announcing yourself. Say again, Roscoe, what did you say about helium balloons?
Does helium rise quicker if it's not in a balloon?
Well, it wouldn't necessarily just rise. So while you're seeing the upward vector when you've got it in a helium balloon, in reality, while it would rise through the atmosphere, it's just going to disperse in all directions. Hope that answers your question. There doesn't seem to be a follow-up.
I sort of knew that, but I was just wondering if the actual balloon itself causes it some weight on it, so it doesn't actually go about its business as quick as what it do without the balloon.
Well, it's keeping a concentration of something of a lower density in a confined area, so you can see the disequilibrium take effect. Whereas if it wasn't contained, it would just expand in all directions and dissipate through all of the availability of volume that it has to fill and become part of the anisotropic dynamic system that we have. But you can show a cool effect by confining it to a balloon so that you can show the relative density disequilibrium that helium has if it's in isolation. But we don't live in an isolated system with all the gases separated. It's anisotropic. It's all mixed up. So therefore, we end up with a dynamic mixture of gases that are all in flux and flow.
Okay, that makes sense. But there is one more question I had. And you may have answered this, but Do gases have speeds?
Yeah. Yes, they do.
So gas particles have a speed.
I mean, I don't know the exact speed. You're talking thousands of miles an hour, though.
Like, if you just release, I don't know, let's say you let out all the helium out of the balloon, that gas expand, that helium expand, obviously in every direction, at a certain speed?
No, because you're describing it in an ideal circumstance. So if you released it into a vacuum, then yeah. But no, you're releasing it into an environment that's got other particles of gas to bounce off of also. So it's not necessarily going to just expand freely into... The only circumstance that you'd have where that would happen would be, for example, if... I mean, it's farcical, but just for the sake of this argument, as farcical as this may seem to you, Roscoe, if the sky was just an empty space, a vacuum, then the gas could unimpededly expand at full velocity into that space. Here at ground level, there's a fairly high concentration of gases for it to bounce off, though. So it's going to take a time to dissipate. But it's still proportional to time. It's still just an effect of entropy.
Yep, that makes sense. Cool, thanks.
My pleasure. Any more on gravity, or are we going to move on?
I want to go back to space-time. Now, how did they pull this one over everybody? When even back then, they knew time was a convention, a concept. What is it exactly they're trying to say when it's uneven distribution of mass and space-time, and then all we get at the end is this effect called gravity?
No, we don't get an effect. We don't get an effect. We get a description in mathematics of a concept to describe how the stars work, how the lights in the sky operate, what they call space. It's a mathematical description that's got a whole load of problems that we could get into if we wanted to. Some of the pseudoscience priests also disclaim the huge glaring problems in this idea and this maths. Maths just being a description. So it's not creating any effects. It's just describing what they see. Pseudoscience, in essence. Just a description based on what they've seen.
Right. We know that. I'm saying they know that. And yet they still are using a calculation as proof when it's not.
No, it's abstract. Maths is abstract. Physics deals with physical. Speaking of physics, or non-physics, any single viable hypothesis from any of the fields of astronomy, cosmology, or astrophysics?
None whatsoever.
No. They can only deal with observations, can't they?
Observe and declare.
They kind of skip the step two, then.
Well, that's what they do, Brian. They make observations at the table with a computer, listening to iTunes, and do science. That's how they do it.
No.
I thought you were going to tell me a big indicting there.
Me too.
I mean, let's do some science. How do you do science looking at a computer screen?
Any evidence of the distance to the sun?
No evidence for the distance to the sun.
Nope.
Mm-hmm. Any evidence?
Angular relations, angular size, angular speed.
I was listening.
Yeah, no proximity.
Arwen and I were listening to 24/7 Discord this morning. Just I said hello, or maybe it was Spurs. I think it might have been Spurs, actually. In any event, they were discussing why does the not actual size, that would be angular size, of the sun not change in not actual size, that would be angular size, as it moves from its not actual refracted position? That was the question they were posing to flat earthers. Obviously, I'm paraphrasing it into the nonsense assertion and question that they're asking. They're just saying, why doesn't the sun change size throughout the day?
And why doesn't because it? It's not a physical object,
maybe? Ooh, got a fish. Pickle Rick.
Well, I have video. First of all, any of you see DITRH's video of the sun fade that he had put out today?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was very good.
I like those.
What, the sun changing in not actual size, shrinking towards the horizon, not going below it. Yeah, cool videos. What was that, Rick?
Hmm?
He said, why doesn't it?
Why doesn't what?
You asked us. You said, why doesn't it, when we were detailing the question that we get asked in regards to why does the not actual size of the sun not change in not actual size as it moves through its not actual position? And you said, well, why doesn't it?
I was mumbling to myself. I was under the impression I was muted. I didn't right. know you unmuted me.
Right, so you mumbled to yourself, well, why doesn't it not actual size not change in not actual size? You pondered that, did you?
He not actually asked.
It's not actual size. Clearly lost.
Do you expect to have a conversation with me?
No, I expect you to mutter down a mic that you didn't realise was on.
Mute me again, please.
Why are you even here, then? Do you want me to kick you out? You're just filling space telling you to be muted. Well, I'll just move you to a different room. No worries. Bye-bye.
What a clown.
Any evidence of a self-perpetuating molten iron core at the centre of a presupposed spherical Earth?
Can we go back to the sun before?
Okay, go ahead, Brian.
That was a not actual ball earther, not actually the...
Go ahead, Brian.
Yeah, I got Dirt's video there if you want to see the part where he does the thing in reverse. It's not, there's no big deal if you want to play.
Can you screen share it? Because that's far easier for me.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If you want me to do that, I'll do.
Yes,
that.
Please.
I have the sound off.
Definitely, yes, please.
Okay, 1 second now.
Oh, you mean also the same one where the drone is not connected to the Earth, but yet you still see the sun moving? Hmm. Look at that.
I love it when you do that, Chocolate. Keep it up.
Here we go. I will. This is, go ahead, Brian. You're presented whenever you're ready.
Okay, 1 second. I'll put it on. I have it ready to go now. Yeah, this is the fade. This is on the end of it when he does in and out with the reverse.
Hello?
We're watching it, Arwen. Can you not see?
Oh, right. Oh, yeah. The sun fades away into a copyright sign. Pretty awesome.
Sun is copyrighted. Does. He's not wrong. There you go. Copyright.
I'm only on Discord, so I'm not actually seeing it.
You can't in Discord. You'd have to tune into the live stream to see it. Copyright.
Maybe it's got a dimmer switch on it.
It was a not actual pun.
A not actual pun?
At least it was lighthearted.
Boom, boom. Thank you very much for sharing it, Brian.
No hassles, Nate. I actually, there was a, you know, Josh Nowicki, remember the lad who took the observations of Chicago across Lake Michigan?
Yeah.
Yeah. He actually has a video I saw yesterday that came out a couple of years ago. And the sun gets bigger, appears to get bigger. It doesn't actually, but it appears to get bigger as it goes towards the horizon due to the atmosphere. So the sun, from what we see, besides its actual size, the sun appears to be getting bigger and smaller different days from different locations.
Right on.
Yeah, I noticed that when it's, I remember Adam saying 10 degrees above the horizon, they don't do any kind of measurements because of the atmosphere and what it does to things. And the moon at night, right as it's rising, looks huge. And then just a few minutes later, just shrinks.
Under the horizon.
Yeah, under the horizon.
In such a manner.
Yeah, and same thing with the sun at times. That's,
can you guys hear me?
Pictures. Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, we hear you.
Yeah, I'm having some internet garbage going on. I was just going to say, how is it that the sun is just fading out in such a manner when we're told that the reason we have sunrises and sunsets is because the Earth is spinning? How could the sun fade out without going beneath the horizon the way they say it does, because we're on a spinning ball?
We're not on a spinning ball.
How can it ever fade out into the horizon like that.
It can't. We're not on a spinning ball. It's not going behind the horizon.
Oh, that sounds like a black swan for horizons. Or, no, black swan for sunrises and sunsets. Because that's never supposed to happen.
Correct.
Ever, ever.
Correct. You should always go behind the turning Earth, they claim. Of course, that would give you 15 degrees an hour deviation as Earth turns underneath. We won't get into that. We've covered it.
We don't see the geometric horizon.
Any evidence of a self-perpetuating molten iron core at the center of a presupposed spherical Earth?
Fairy tale. They can't even get the first five questions.
We cover I think we did. Yeah, we've covered them all. That's it. That concludes housekeeping.
I'll tell you, all you gotta do is listen to Fight the Flat Earth, Fumble, Beg the Question on every housekeeping question on that show that you had to see how desperate they are.
Oh, Neil.
If we were able to drill directly through the Earth and come out the other side, would I be upright?
This is a very lovely thought experiment, but we're not on a sphere. Neil's asking, hypothetically, if we drill a tunnel from one side of a presupposed spherical Earth through the molten iron core to the other side, if he climbs in the tunnel head first and crawls all the way down this tunnel, not that that's possible, he'd just fall. Anyway, would he climb out the other side head first, having climbed in head first, and be right side up? In other words, he pops his head out and looks at people's feet standing on the other side. That's what he's asking.
Yes.
Molten iron will
burn him. You're begging the question, Neil.
Yeah, on so many levels, it's wrong, 10th. I'll paraphrase it so at least the audience were clear what he was asking.
And that's what my son said. When you get to the other side, I'll be standing upright.
He's assuming there's another side and it's a sphere.
Yeah, he's assuming. It's akin to assuming that if I observe stars in the north and then travel to what is called the south, that my journey took me to be antipodal to where I began, i.e. standing upside down if you're looking at both at the same time, one is upside down to the other. But your travel leads you to being antipodal in positioning terms to where you began. Well, that's a presupposition. It's just a fallacy that you're employing. I assume I'm travelling to the other side of a sphere. So you're assuming a sphere, and assuming when you get to the other side of it, you're antipodal. Yeah, no. Basically, no.
Neil, the molten iron core will burn you.
And that's not the biggest problem, Roscoe.
there is no core. That didn't happen, and they stopped drilling because they would prove that it's a flat Earth.
I don't think it proves it's not the biggest
problem about the molten iron core. What about depressurization? What if a big enough hole through the crust came, and then the gas pressure expansion and all that, it's probably gonna rip the planet apart
or deflate like a big balloon because you're popping it.
Right, exactly.
I keep losing
all
the
heat is all gonna transform into gaseous things that are just gonna vent off, and then it's gonna shrivel up the Earth.
If they ever drilled that way, Neil, we would be able to dismantle their argument.
Right, I just very burnt. Boom, boom. Right, Neil, just because they assert with logical fallacy that something proves a sphere doesn't mean that if you're asserting it from your standpoint, like drilling, for whatever reason, proves a flat Earth. It doesn't have to be the case that the antithesis of their argument, in this case, well, we've drilled 8 miles down and therefore P waves and S waves that didn't prove what they were actually going to drill through correct, proves that there's a molten iron core at the centre of my presupposition that Earth's a sphere. Well, it doesn't mean that you've got to turn that into, well, they drilled down 8 miles, therefore proving it's flat. Because it doesn't prove anything either way unless you attach a logical fallacy to it. You've been told, Neil.
I say when people are thinking about digging through the Earth, well, we haven't technically even made it.
8 miles was what Chocolate just said before he broke up.
Oh, I thought he was going to say we haven't even gone past 1.22 miles for the geometric horizon.
Black swan.
careful. We should try to get to 9. Or, yeah. Hello. Hello, hello.
Yeah, yeah. You're here.
No? Okay. Oh, okay. No, I was saying, people thinking about, oh, let's dig through the earth. What would happen? Well, we haven't even made it like a full 8 miles, right? Because the whole super deep polar borehole, what, like 7.6 miles or something? Maybe we should get to like 8 or 9 before we start thinking about what's going on the other side. That might help.
And chocolate,
maybe a strong 10.
Chaka, do you or anyone know exactly why they were digging that hole? What were they trying to prove, and found out that it didn't prove what they were looking for?
Oh, I don't know what the purpose was.
Wasn't it something about what they expected to have there, but it wasn't there, and it destroyed everything?
Well, yeah, they had certain predictions that they thought they were making, and those predictions kind of got thrown to the wayside, from what I know. But yeah, you might want to make it to 10 miles or 9 before talking about what's going on 4,000 miles down, let alone another 4,000 after that.
Are you listening, like, Arwin?
Just joke,
Arwin?
Joke level.
Are you listening?
Me?
Yeah, you say, I don't know what P waves and S waves, how it works, what it disproves, what it proves. Chocolate's just detailed how P waves and S waves are used to estimate what they were going to drill through when they dug just under 8 miles in Russia with the hole to hell. Well, that hole to hell, in terms of their estimations of what they'd be cutting through, was proven wrong. So the P waves and S waves were inaccurate in terms of a prediction of what they were going to be drilling through, where they thought they'd be drilling through, oh, I don't know, granite. They ended up being water. You know what I mean? It was just wrong. Yeah. So when they say, well, we've scanned down with P waves and S waves and know there's a molten iron core, well, they can't even go 0.1% into the crust of the earth, according to their religious beliefs and assertions, and get it right. So how reliable do you think P waves and S waves are when they're going orders of magnitudes further? Well, not very is the answer. Just so you know, Arwin, because you've always said, I don't know why. Well, now you do.
No. I didn't. I just didn't know exactly what they were. I know it had kind of to do with echo location, with sound-based things. And I knew about the problems with it, that over distance, the more material it goes through, especially if it's different types of material, and if the pressure is higher and all that, the readouts become very exponentially more erratic over a linear distance pretty shortly. That's what I learned about it. Don't know technically what the P and S waves literally are, though, but I know it's in that direction, and it's basically in its baby steps. You know, in Star Trek, they like to say, oh yeah, we're just going to scan it from orbit and just go kilometer down, and yo, we can scan, there's caverns there. Yeah, that's if the P waves and S waves were absolutely perfected, but they aren't. They've never left the baby steps, and they just kind of dropped it after it turned out to be such a massive failure.
Sure, but it's still asserted as a proof that we've got a molten iron core. You'll still have that thrown at you, and you know, I didn't realize your understanding was it. I mean, it doesn't really matter what they are. You know, you can think of them as being unicorn laser farts. It doesn't matter.
Well, what's glaring about what the back and forth you had with Arwin is that they say they know what's at 4,000 or 3,959 or whatever. But they were wrong on what was at 8 miles.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, the errors pile up exponentially over a linear distance. It's like how many rice pieces on every square of a chessboard, you know? It starts to become a lot. You underestimate that. And that's the same problem with the scanning through materials. Over distance, it becomes exponentially more difficult to get a precise kind of estimation out of it.
I have a question to throw out there. I've been looking at, when I asked earlier about the moon, what rate it moves around us at. It moves around us, according to the internet, 12 to 13 degrees a day, or over 24 hours. It moves at 0.5 degrees an hour. This is what the speed the moon moves at. Now, the sun moves around us at 15 degrees an hour, but that's we're told, because we're rotating. And it's the us moving around the sun, and us rotating once a day gives us the sun moving around us 15 degrees an hour. So that makes it 360 degrees in 24 hours. But the moon is moving. The sun is not in the heliocentric model, as in we're moving around it. It's not, and we're rotating once a day in that model. The moon is moving around us. But the moon and the sun all come from the east and go to the west. So it rises in the east and it sets in the west. The moon supposedly, rises and sets 50 minutes later each day. But if the moon is actually moving and it's going east to west, and we're going west to east, then, now this could be totally unthought out and it could be totally wrong. But shouldn't the moon be moving through the sky faster if we're the ones rotating? As the sun is not rotating. We see the sun supposedly going around us because we're supposedly rotating once a day. But that, the sun is also supposed to be kind of stationary, whereas the moon is actually moving around us. And it's moving east to west, that's how we view it, because we're told that the Earth is turning west to east. But if the moon is actually moving, and the sun is not, then shouldn't we see the moon moving faster than the sun, as opposed to the opposite way around? Because stationary, it would be the sun moving at 15 degrees an hour around us, and the moon moving at 0.5 degrees an hour, as we absolutely see.
I see what you mean.
Yeah, so
the moon is actually moving. It's not supposed to be due to Earth spinning. It's actually supposed to be moving around Earth.
So, yeah, because we orbit the sun, but the moon orbits us, according to them.
Right, but we see the sunrise and sunset due to the rotation of Earth in their narrative.
Yeah.
But the moon is actually supposed to be moving around us, independent of the rotation of Earth.
Yeah, I mean, what we see of it is still connected to the rotation, but it's actually moving, and it's moving east to west. So if it's actually moving, and the sun is not, let's say we're moving around it, then the whole point, the whole point is that the moon should be moving faster. If we are rotating, the moon should be moving faster in our sky than the sun. But it doesn't. We see the opposite. The sun moves faster in our sky, and the moon moves slower.
And with that, I'm going to say, first and foremost, a huge, massive, enormous thank you to both Discord and G+ Panels for making today's live show possible. If you are watching this on either Nathan Oakley 1980 or Nathan Oakley premiering streams, then stay tuned, as there will be an after show to follow. Massive thank you to all of you did tune in live, smash the super chat, including Rakia Life, who just donated $99.99. He says, to everyone who wonders why I support Nathan and not their chan, I support truth. I like truth. Rakia Life. Thank you very much indeed for the super chat. Dave Rakia Gafford, or Rakia Life, really do appreciate your support. Once again, stay tuned if you're watching on either premiering stream. I've been Nathan Oakley, and I'll see you all in the next video.
Move.